Well, you see, that's another thing I wanted to ask you. What you thought as an artist about using sound tracks that is clearly dance music, 80s dance music.
Yeah.
So sorting that out first and then getting to the images afterwards.
Mm.
The reason I asked that is I went to a show called A Celebration of Failure, which was Laura Kakalka. Well, yeah, except that the failure is public taste, I think. that was just my take on it.
That makes it even better.
Well, yeah, it is even better. I can see where the artists are coming from. Because magically, all this stuff had been rearranged in the gallery, and it looked wonderful.
Yeah.
But the premise was that as individual pieces,
yeah.
Maybe it wasn't the sort of normal gallery, I think. Well, yeah. Irritainment, to be as fair as I can,
yeah.
She talks about irritainment, which is something that's so irritating it's also entertaining. Or it started out as entertainment and it's now been made through art to be irritating.
Yeah.
But do you see what, you can see what the sort of, sort of direction it's going in.
Yeah.
And some of it I didn't agree with. There were original singles from Philadelphia Records that were on the floor. You could walk all over them, which I didn't think was quite right. But the idea of it was that there's a popular culture which has been transcended somehow.
Mm.
And also you could become a DJ.
Right.
There was a record player there and all these albums, vinyl, 12-inch, which I had a look at and I... not only played some, I'd started bringing in my own because my taste sort of crosses over.
That's great.
And when she went back to Berlin, she left a lot of the stuff behind. She really didn't rate it very highly. So I have a collection of about half a dozen of these vinyl LPs, and I've actually put quite a bit of it on YouTube as a mix.
Amazing. Yeah.
Which is Non-Stop Dancing 1972 James Last. which is where it starts, you see. And the James Last fans have clicked on it a lot. And
they love it.
They love it. And my stats show they keep listening even when even when other stuff comes on. James Last is the first 3 or 4 minutes.
Yeah.
And... So, where am I going with this? Yeah, JD, my colleague, when it becomes The Wild Show, which it will at 10, and you're welcome to stay, he also does an 80s show.
Yeah.
And I think it's just a certain point in your life. He thinks the 70s are completely naff. But I think he was just not allowed out.
He wasn't allowed a chopper.
No,
right? He wasn't allowed.
So he was. My theory, JD, he was supposed to be on holiday, but he may be listening.
Yeah.
So what I think is, well, it probably happens to most people, that when you're mostly at home and you're listening to daytime radio, you think a lot of the songs are a bit naff.
Yeah.
But when you're allowed out and you start going to clubs or whatever you do,
yeah, you can see them in context, I guess.
Well, you don't see the same acts, do you?
No.
You hear different sort of music.
Yeah.
So, when I've tried to say all this negative feel about the 70s, which I thought came over in the Celebration of Failure, I don't really agree with it.
Mm.
I can't persuade him of it because he agrees with it, you see. So, if we got as far as the 1980s, we could sort of approach it in a slightly different way, that we start out thinking the 80s are positive.
Mm.
And we start with the soundtrack.
Yeah.
You've already found the sort of relax room music.
And
when you track it down, you know about it.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
We'll find that. So then we want a mix of music that is danceable.
Yeah.
That we're not sending up in any way.
Okay. That's quite difficult with the 80s.
You reckon? You think? Yeah. Okay.
As someone who's kind of a teenager in the 80s, I've kind of found it to be almost like, it's almost like a parody of itself, the 80s, I think. But,
so you might do a mix that was ironic.
Well, possibly. I think I'd stick with the chill out stuff.
Okay.
That is also kind of ironic.
My thought is that we do a sort of follow up. I mean, Laura Kakalka, I have found an email address that doesn't bounce.
Oh, great.
So, which, you know, but she hasn't sort of come back to say, oh, yes, I can see what where you're going with this. But if she doesn't want to do it, we could do it anyway.
Yeah.
And we'd start with the sound.
Yeah.
Do you see what I mean? So the images could come later.
Yeah.
So if there are any graphic artists listening, or who find this later, or we'll try and find
some. Or video artists, I guess.
Or video artists, yeah.
Filmmakers.
So there could be screens.
Yeah.
As part of the environment. And it could be a club or a gallery. Doesn't really matter, does it?
No, it could be, as long as it's a space where people can come and experience it.
Or we could do versions of it.
Yeah. Could tour it.
Well, yeah. And let other people be part of it as it goes along.
Yeah.
Well, that's very good. And then the other thing, we got about 10 minutes, so some of the other idea I had.
Yeah.
Animated Exeter, and this I haven't spoken to them about this. This is just something which occurs to me.
Yeah.
They commission sometimes images on the side of buildings.
Yeah.
And then they have a soundtrack to it. But I find sometimes there are copyright issues around the sound that has been used.
Yeah.
Or there's an artist involved that you think, well, maybe they wouldn't want their sound smashed up at all.
Yeah.
So I find it sort of difficult to work with that as openly or variously as I'd like to. Because the images, once you get projection onto a building, which, by the way, you can do through Photoshop or something. You can mix and match architecture and something else. So that's not the problem. And because you've got so many cameras in the streets, you've got loads and loads of images. But usually you haven't got a good soundtrack.
Yeah.
And you're not quite sure what you can do with it, with the soundtrack anyway. But I wonder if you'd consider doing a soundtrack that could be used, that would be on a Creative Commons basis.
Yeah, I'd be happy to do that. I guess the other thing you could do, of course, is invite, if you had something where people were projecting onto buildings, invite someone to play live.
Oh, right.
So improvise music according to what they've just been projected. Which would be interesting to do. I guess they'd have to kind of have some idea of what the images were that were coming up, but it could be an interesting experiment.
Well, they could do it several times, couldn't they?
Yeah.
But then, do you think the same band would want, because, like, say it was over three nights from about 2 or 3 hours a night, would they want to stay there live the whole of that
time?
Well,
you don't have to have the same band. You could invite people to Kevin. I think a lot of bands who, certainly in my experience when I used to play what I call proper bands with proper songs, is that it gets a bit boring. And if you get a chance to just jam, inspired by some visuals, that's probably more fun.
Okay.
So you might get some people who just go, yeah, this is something completely different to do. Let's have a go at it.
Okay.
You'd have to, I guess Soundgallery is a good place to ask for people if they're, you know, if they've got people who might want to do that.
Well, yeah, they're just along the corridor.
Yeah,
so
yeah, they've got lots of musicians there, so
we could
approach like the music department at Exeter College and people like that.
Right, okay.
Say, how would your students like to experience something very different to what they're.
Right, but we'd make it Creative Commons explicit, up front, because
then
we
people
know we
know.
Can do
exactly right. Yeah, because then people know what they're kind of donating, whatever they create, to the greater good.
Right. Yeah. Well, that all makes sense. Now I'm trying to remember what I haven't asked you. I think it has to be about the beer festival.
Oh,
As a beer festival.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's another one coming up, which is going to be at Seal Hain in mid-August.
Right.
Which is where John Mayhew and myself are going to go. I do another show called We Don't Know, which is on Tuesdays.
Mm-hmm.
Tuesdays between 12 and 2. And we like Seal Hain. We go there for Access All Aerials, which is a radio show they do there.
Yeah.
And I think that's going to be an interesting occasion, because they're going to have a lot of music there. And it's a very good site.
Yeah.
But I just wonder what you think is going on with beer festivals, because they're another sort of social occasion. They have a sort of content marketing approach, I would say, because that's the other explanation of what happens online, that people are giving away bits and pieces because they think they'll sell something else.
Yeah.
So there's the whole theory around content marketing,
mm.
and there's also a theory around if you get a good band. And charge a reasonable amount for the beer, you'll
end make
up
money.
quitting at the end of the day.
That's pretty much how all music venues work.
You reckon they all do?
Well,
on that basis.
Yeah, licensed music venues definitely work on that premises, that people will, the beer sells for so much and they make so much on the markup that they can sell enough beer to pay the band and make a profit as well.
Right.
I guess the other thing is, if there's bands playing and you can't really talk to your friends because it's that loud, you're going to drink more beer. Than if that's actually true. But it could be the case. If you look at nightclubs, I guess nightclubs do that as well. They have like standing room only, and because people who sit down drink slower. And if the music's that loud, you can't really hear anyone speaking. You might just dance,
right?
Which will make you thirsty, and then you'll go and drink some more beer. I'm not sure if that's been studied, but it probably has, I'm sure.
But, so, what's happened with the Exeter Beer Festival seems to be that the castle was too difficult a venue.
Yeah.
Because it wasn't really set up for outside events.
No, not really.
On a sufficient scale.
Yeah.
So they used the football club.
Yeah.
So do you go to the winter one?
I've not been to the one, any of the ones at the football club actually, so I'm not sure what they're like.
Well, they have a lot less music.
Right.
Because I think I'm right in saying that. I think on the grounds it's quite hard to predict.
Yeah.
As to how many people are going to turn up. And so forth. So I think they just settle for beers there.
Right.
But the Silhane one, we'll take a good look at that. Because I think that's going to be an opportunity for some music.
Yeah.
And maybe some conversation as well.
Mm.
I'm going to keep the idea of a chat show based at a beer festival.
That's a good idea.
Well, it seems like, I mean, it's good that you've come into the studio as well.
You can actually hear what I'm saying.
Yeah, I can hear what you're saying. We're hoping the recording is going to be good.
Yeah. Yeah. I thought that's one problem, I guess, with outdoor beer festivals is, if you did a chat show at a beer festival, it'd be fine, but you'd have to have some kind of like screening to screen out some of the acoustic background noise. Or a little area to sit, like a sofa to sit down on, with like acoustic screens around it, so you could interview people and.
Yeah, maybe you need a special space.
Yeah, yeah, that might be a way of doing it.
Well, maybe it's just a way of getting an outline of what people are prepared to say, and then ask them again in the studio sometime later.
Yeah, it could be. Yeah, just something I wanted to mention there. You mentioned, because we were talking about Creative Commons licensing earlier, and now we've moved on to beer.
Right.
There's actually an open source beer that's released under a Creative Commons license.
A beer.
So it's actually free beer, but it's free as in the instructions on how to brew it are online, and you can brew your own and sell it as free beer.
Have you ever drunk any of this?
I've not, no, unfortunately. I'm not that into homebrew anymore. So, but I just like the idea of. But then you could, in theory, a pub could brew it and sell it as free beer. So you're going, would you like some free beer? That's £3.90, please. But you said it was free. No, no, not free as in free. Free as in open source free.
Well, I wonder if they'd sell it any cheaper.
Well, I don't know.
Well, that's another challenge we could set. I wonder because there's a lot of breweries, small-scale breweries around.
Yeah. Maybe we can see if there's any around here that would like to produce some free beer for us.
We understand they'd have to charge something for it. But would it be any cheaper? That's the question.
Well, probably not, I guess. I'm sure that most breweries, they know how to brew beer anyway. So it's not, I guess what the free beer thing is giving you is the instructions on how to make it.
You don't think they're paying any patent information?
No.
No.
No, I doubt it.
They know. They know already.
They already know. They already have that secret knowledge.
The other thing I'm going to mention, because I've been mentioning it over the next few weeks, is Sidmouth and folk music.
Mm-hmm.
Because I've found Sidmouth is a really good place for A, for talking to people, but B, for recording bits and pieces.
Mm-hmm.
Certainly the first videos that I did with musicians was in Sidmouth. and I think it's because of the folk background. So there's something about this Creative Commons and early internet attitudes, or continuing internet attitudes for a lot of people, that sort of goes back to something. So I wonder if folk music, or where you rate your own music alongside folk music, or how that might fit together.
Good point, I guess. If you look at historically at folk music, it was music by the people, for the people. You can't get more kind of Creative Commons than that, really, I guess. Someone would write a song and then it was played by other people. You've got traditional arrangements of songs which are, somebody must have written somewhere along the line, that have become just generic folk songs. And that kind of sharing is definitely the same as kind of Creative Commons stuff. I guess equally, though, sometimes people might have lifted part of a folk song to create a new piece of work that's their own. So like an analog equivalent of sampling. Someone might go, oh, I really like the chorus on that folk song, so I'm going to change the words to it. And you get parody folk songs, for example, which are based on like the Wild Rover or whatever, but they've got a kind of a comic element to them.
Right.
And that is kind of like remixing in an analog form, isn't it? It's rewriting that song, using elements of an original folk song and making it your own.
Right.
So it's just like an analog world equivalent of sampling, I guess.
Well, yeah, but again, the copyright thing comes into it.
Yeah, but I guess that's the thing. If you've got songs that are either out of copyright because they're so old, or never were in copyright because they're traditional,
right?
Then you can do what you like with them. So it's kind of like Creative Commons before Creative Commons existed, because they already were in the Commons, if you like.
Right.
So maybe we'll see a surge in the future of, with Creative Commons licensed stuff, of more kind of, what's the word I'm looking for? Peer-to-peer kind of remixing, because there's suddenly going to be a wider amount of stuff you can sample from, or use or rewrite to your own purposes.
Right. So, which of the sites do you use at the moment that have a Creative Commons? Are you still using Internet Archive to upload things to?
Yeah, I'm still using archive.org mostly. Upload and download things from as well. There's quite a lot of interesting video stuff on there which you can download to remix, which is great. And texts and all sorts of things. But there are other... there's a whole range of different websites. Things like SoundCloud, you can use Creative Commons licensing on as well.
Right.
So if you're a musician, you can put your own stuff up there, and you can either restrict it so that people can't download it, or in my case, I make all my stuff downloadable and say pretty much do what you like with it.
So what's your name on SoundCloud?
It's Sufi Boy again.
Right, okay.
Yeah, that keeps it simple there.
Right, so Sufi Boy.
Yeah.
If you just joined us, so I should say again, this is Phonic FM 106.8 or www.phonic.fm, and we've got to stop fairly soon, but our guest has been and is Simon Egan. He's just looking at his watch.
Yeah, I've got to go somewhere in a minute.
Well, we're after 10 o'clock.
Yeah.
So Simon, look, thank you.
You're very welcome.
I think it's been a brilliant conversation.
Yeah, it has been quite enjoyable.
We haven't stopped for music.
No, didn't need to. Keep talking all day.
Yeah. So look, I'll do an edit.
Yeah.
And I think I'll probably stretch it out over the next next 3 weeks.
Well, I'll email you links to some of the things I've talked about, so you can perhaps download some bits of my stuff and the other stuff I've talked about.
Great. And if when I listen to it there's some obvious gaps, maybe you can come again another day.
Yeah, I should be able to, I think. I'm not always off work on Thursdays, but if I am.
Right, okay.
I'll pop in.
No, that's great.
Great, thanks for having me, Rob.
So it's been really good.
You're welcome.
Yeah, okay. See you again
soon.
Bye then. I'll play a record and see you out. So this is a group called Broken Bells.